Welcome to a lesson on the complex factorization theorem. In this lesson, we'll define the theorem and then use the theorem to find all the zeros of a polynomial function. A polynomial function of degree n with complex coefficients in this form here has exactly n complex zeros as long as we count multiplicity. So notice how here we're not just talking about real zeros, we're talking about complex zeros. So if we count complex zeros, the number of complex zeros will always match the degree of the polynomial as long as we count multiplicity. So if these r's are the complex zeros with multiplicity given by these m's, we can write a polynomial function as a product of linear factors, as we see here, where again the r's would be the zeros and the m's would be the multiplicities. It's important to keep in mind that now we're talking about complex zeros or complex numbers, where complex numbers are made up of the set of real numbers and the imaginary numbers in the form of a plus or minus bi. Let's take a look at our first example. Here we want to write the given polynomial function, which is a degree 3 polynomial function, as a product of linear factors, or factors of degree 1, and then find the zeros and state the multiplicity of each. We know from our previous lesson on the rational roots theorem that if this polynomial function does have real rational roots, it must be a ratio of the factors of the constant term, in this case negative 80, to the factors of the leading coefficient, which in this case would be 1. To save some time, I've already listed the factors of negative 80 and the factors of 1, but instead of using trial and error to figure out which ratio would be a real zero to the given function, let's go ahead and graph the function and see if we can find a real rational zero as an x-intercept. So here's the graph of the given function. Notice how there is an x-intercept here at 5. This would be the point 5, 0, and therefore 5 is a zero of the given polynomial function. And if 5 is a zero, then x minus 5 must be a factor of the given function. So again, if 5 is a 0 and x minus 5 is a factor, we can write the given function as p of x would have to be equal to the factor of x minus 5 times a degree 2 quadratic factor. In order to find this degree 2 quadratic factor, we can take the given polynomial function and divide by x minus 5. To do this, let's use synthetic division. So for dividing by x minus 5, we'll use the constant 5 when using synthetic division. And now we'll list the coefficients of the polynomial function, which will be 1, negative 5, 16, negative 80. Now to begin, we'll bring down this 1 and start multiplying by 5. 5 times 1 is 5, goes here, and then we add. Be 0. 5 times 0 is 0. Add, that's 16. And 5 times 16 is 80, and we add. And this last column is 0, which is good news. This would be our remainder. Since the remainder is 0, x minus 5 divide evenly into the polynomial function, which is what we expected. This would be the degree 2 factor. This represents 1x squared plus 0x plus 16, or x squared plus 16. But again, our goal here is to write this as a product of linear factors, or factors of degree 1. And since x squared plus 16 doesn't factor, we'll actually have to find the zeros of x squared plus 16, and then use those zeros to write this as two linear factors. Let's go ahead and do that part on the next slide. Again, our goal is to write p of x as a product of linear factors. So to find the linear factors of x squared plus 16, we're actually going to find the values of x that make this equal to 0, or find the zeros of this, and then use those zeros to find the remaining two factors. So we actually want to solve x squared plus 16 equals 0 to find the remaining two zeros of p of x, and therefore find the remaining two linear factors. So if we subtract 16 on both sides, and then take the square root of both sides, don't forget we'll have a plus or minus here. We'll have x equals plus or minus the square root of negative 16, which is negative 1 times 16, which would give us x equals plus or minus 4i. So the two remaining zeros would be x equals 4i and x equals negative 4i. Therefore, the two remaining linear factors would be x minus 4i and x minus negative 4i, or x plus 4i. Let's go ahead and summarize this. We just found the polynomial function can be written as a product of linear factors as x minus 5 times x minus 4i times x plus 4i. And the zeros, which all have multiplicity 1, are x equals 5, x equals 4i, and x equals negative 4i. Let's take a look at a second example. Same question, but now we have a degree 4 polynomial function. So again, we'll start by determining the real rational zeros of the given function, which we could use the rational roots theorem by finding the ratio of the factors of the constant term to the factors of the leading coefficient, and use these ratios in trial and error to find a real rational zero of this function. But again, let's go ahead and graph the function instead. Here's the graph of our function. Notice how there is an x-intercept here at the point 2, 0. But notice how the graph behaves at this x-intercept. It doesn't cross through the x-axis like it does when the multiplicity is odd. It touches it and then turns in the other direction, which means the zero of x equals 2 has an even multiplicity. And if x equals 2 is a zero, x minus 2 would have to be a factor. And because we have a degree 4 polynomial function, x equals 2 either has multiplicity 2 or multiplicity 4. Let's begin by assuming it has multiplicity 2. If we assume it has multiplicity 2, that means we could write the function as p of x equals 2 factors of x minus 2. So we have x minus 2 squared times what would be a degree 2 factor. So to find this degree 2 factor here, we'll actually divide the given polynomial by x minus 2 twice and see what factor remains. So we'll set this up as synthetic division. So we'll use the 0, 2, and then we'll list the coefficients of the polynomial function, which are 1, negative 8, 33, negative 68, and 52. So now again, we'll bring the 1 down, start multiplying by 2, 2 times 1 is 2, add, that's negative 6, multiply, that's negative 12, add, that's 21, multiply, that's 42, add, that's negative 26, multiply, that's 52, and we have a remainder of 0, which is good news. We just divided by x minus 2 once, and now let's do it again. Bring down the 1, 2 times 1 is 2, add, negative 4, multiply, negative 8, add, 13, multiply, and add, that's 0. Again, that's good news again because we have another remainder of 0. So x minus 2 divided twice into the given polynomial function. This represents a degree 2 factor that remains, which would be 1x squared minus 4x plus 13. And this doesn't factor, so what we're going to do is work backwards again, find the zeros of this, and then use those zeros to find the remaining linear factors of the given polynomial function. So to find the zeros of x squared minus 4x plus 13, we're going to solve this equation by using the quadratic formula given here below, where a is equal to 1, b is equal to negative 4, and c is equal to 13. So we would have x equals negative, negative 4, that's 4, plus or minus the square root of b squared, negative 4 squared is 16, minus 4 times a times c. 4 times a is 4 times c, that would be 52. Divide all this by 2 times a, or 2 times 1, which is 2. So we have x equals 4 plus or minus the square root of, this would be negative 36 divided by 2. X equals 4 plus or minus the square root of negative 36 would be 6i divided by 2. So we have x equals 4 divided by 2 plus or minus 6i divided by 2, or x equals 2 plus or minus 3i. So we can use these two complex zeros to find the remaining two linear factors of our polynomial function. Let's go ahead and finish this on the next slide. We would have p of x equals x minus 2 squared times x minus the 0 of 2 plus 3i, and then x minus the 0 of 2 minus 3i. So now we have the polynomial function as a product of linear factors, and these zeros are x equals 2 that has multiplicity 2, and we have x equals 2 plus 3i, and x equals 2 minus 3i, both of which have multiplicity 1. I hope you found this helpful.